Okay, next up, three of our nine staff attorneys will give the much-awaited legal report, which we're calling FFRF on a Roll. And you've been introduced to them before, so please welcome again Rebecca Markert, Legal Director, Andrew Seidel, Director of Strategic Response, and Patrick Elliott, Senior Counsel.
Hello again. So we are running behind, so we're going to try to curb the desire to talk a lot, as lawyers like to do. And I'll get started right away. So over the past year, we've accomplished a lot. And one of the biggest things is, one of the biggest milestones we achieved this year is 10 years of the FFRF in-house legal department. As Dan mentioned, I was the first staff attorney. Thank you. As Dan mentioned, I was the first staff attorney hired back in 2008, and we quickly learned that we needed more help. And we hired Patrick, and then very soon after, Andrew, and we kept growing since then. And it's been very fruitful, because over the last 10 years, our legal department has sent over 14,000 letters of complaint to government entities. We've obtained over 1,500 victories that we know about. It's astonishing how many times we don't actually hear about our victorious letters. We've handled over 50 lawsuits in-house. Obviously, that's just in the last 10 years, not the entirety of FFRF. And we've submitted over 25 amicus briefs in courts around the country. And this is only some of the stuff we've handled. It's pretty impressive for the last 10 years, and we are definitely still on a roll. So this September, we added another new staff member to our legal department, Christina DeLeiden. She's back there waving. She joined our team in September as a second legal assistant and paralegal, which brings our team to 11 permanent staff. And that is your 2018 legal team. We also have one of our legal fellows here in San Francisco tonight. You've been seeing him walking around this weekend taking pictures. Chris Line, I don't know where he is, but if you see him, oh, he's back there. Our legal fellows are with us for a period of 2 years, right after graduation, and then they go off into the world with this background under their belts as well. So this year, we also hired 5 law student interns and 2 undergraduate interns. And here's a picture of some of them on a boat cruise that we took at the end of the summer, thanking them for their work. So as you know, the FFRF legal department fights the battle of church and state in 3 different ways. One of those is through education or non-litigation advocacy. We write letters of complaint to government entities trying to stop violations before going to court, but sometimes that's not always the case and we do have to litigate. And then we've been working on other forms of advocacy, like lobbying and fighting the battle in the court of public opinion, so writing letters to elected officials and issuing press statements, what we like to term in-house as strategic response. So today, I'm going to tell you about our non-litigation efforts in the education realm. Then Patrick's going to come up and talk about some of our litigation efforts. And then Andrew's going to close with his work on strategic response. We do hope to have time for some questions, but we are running behind. But we're here all weekend, so you can come up and talk to us at any time. But first, I'm going to tell you more statistics from the last year. As you know, we handle litigation. And since the last convention, we have initiated 5 new lawsuits. We've carried over 11 ongoing cases from the last convention, and we've received 8 victories in our cases. 2 of those have been closed, so they are done, but 6 of them are pending appeal. As we've grown, we've also been able to grow our amicus practice, and in the last year, we've submitted 5 amicus briefs in courts around the country, including 2 to the U.S. Supreme Court. And Patrick's going to go into detail about all of those. As you may know, we primarily handle things in the non-litigation realm, trying to resolve these without going through the expense of litigation. We try to resolve these through letter writing. Our members call us and ask us for our advice. And since last year's convention in Madison, we've written 1,241 letters of complaint to government officials around the country. In 2018 alone, we've sent out 814 letters. And we've gotten 356 victories on those letters of complaint since the last convention. And in this year alone, we've gotten 255. Of course, we also handle a lot of intake. Every year, we get about 3,500 to 4,000 contacts about potential state church violations that our intake team has to go through. And this year, we've gotten through 2,632 of those. So let me start telling you some of the interesting stuff about our non-litigation efforts. One of our biggest areas of complaint is religion in the public schools. It accounts for over half of what we deal with on a yearly basis. And the majority of those are corrected by just sending letters of complaint. Because the law is so clear on what is permissible in the public school context. But despite this clear precedent, we are still reminding superintendents, teachers, public football coaches that it's not okay to pray with their students. And this year, our team was really busy stopping prayer over loudspeakers, particularly in the South. Chris Line, one of our legal fellows, has been especially prolific in stopping these violations in Georgia and Alabama. He's been pretty busy this past year. So I have a clip with some of our complaints from those states.
For as long as many of those neighbors in Blount County can remember, a student or volunteer has led a prayer over the public address system before football games. That all ends Friday after a complaint from an outside organization. Under Friday night lights at Blount County schools, any pregame prayers will now have to be unplugged.
We believe that prayer should be in school, and when there's not, then obviously the country doesn't have blessing.
We as Christians are being silenced, and so we have to go with the majority that's very loud.
A complaint prompted Hewitt Trustville students to say their own prayer during a moment of silence last year. Now, there were a few people who reached out to me in social media context who live in Blount County that said they don't really feel like religion should be forced on everyone, but they don't want to speak out against the majority.
Lord, we thank you, God, for another day. We thank you for an opportunity play a game that we call football.
This is the video at the center of a complaint against the Dawson County School District. According to the Freedom from Religion Foundation, it shows Pastor Russell Davis praying with the Dawson County High School football team ahead of a game earlier this month. According to the complaint, Davis is a pastor at a local church and was at one time listed on the football team's website as the football character coach. The Freedom from Religion Foundation says Davis's actions promote religion and are a clear violation of the First Amendment.
The Dawson County School Superintendent responded to the complaint by saying the district is committed to following the parameters set forth in the First Amendment. We believe that our coaches have an understanding of those guidelines and will abide by them.
So those were a couple of our many victories with school prayer on the football field. But we've also dealt with prayer graduations. Last year in Canton Public Schools in Massachusetts, they invited a Reverend John Tamilio III to lead the prayer at graduation. Our legal fellow, Colin McNamara, was able to send them a letter saying that this practice was specifically struck down 26 years ago in their neighboring state of Rhode Island. The school district, of course, quickly agreed to stop the practice, but not before the pastor went over news and told everybody that we were nothing more than big bullies. So our friend and fellow staff attorney, Sam Grover, gets to handle a lot of the complaints out of the state of Texas, which are always fun and exciting, especially in the public school context. There's always something new under the sun, it seems like, in Texas. And this complaint involved a high school where the teachers were allowed to decorate their doors during the month of December. So this particular teacher decided to decorate his door with a Christmas tree and then included the biblical verse that starts, "For unto us a child is born." He didn't stop there, though. He popped this up onto his Facebook page for everyone to see. And then somebody aptly asked him, "Can you put scripture on your door?" But then she says, "That's awesome. No school my kids have ever been in would have allowed anything close to that," which is part of the reason we're homeschooling now. And then he replied, "Can I? I did," with a bunch of emojis. But Sam wrote a letter to the school district, and they did reprimand him for his conduct. So it's not just teachers who put up biblical passages on the walls of school or doors. It's also school administrators. So this is a special education bathroom here in California at the Glenn A. Wilson High School. They put up the quote, "With God, all things are possible," in the bathroom. I don't know. But FFRF Associate Counsel Elizabeth Cavell wrote a letter of complaint, and the school district's attorney reported that they did have that covered. So religious displays are another common area of complaint that we regularly handled. Cross displays are particularly common, and increasingly common is this veterans memorial cutout that you see there on the left. This pops up in various places, mostly city parks, but this one popped up at the VA Medical Center in Iowa. You may know that a few years back, American Humanist Association sued over this exact cross cutout with our attorney, David Kalyanitis, and they won a victory here in Lake Elsinore, California, saying that this particular memorial is unconstitutional. So because of that case, we've been very successful in writing letters of complaint to cities and VA medical centers about this specific cross and having them remedy it in some way. Here, they modified the memorial instead of removing it, but they added the RIP grave marker, which I do think is a victory for all veterans of various faiths and no faiths who have to visit the medical center. So of course, we receive a lot of seasonal display complaints in December. This is in the city of Dover, Ohio, which actually had the Holy Trinity of displays. They had crosses up in December, the nativity scene, and then the Ten Commandments that were displayed all year round. Our legal fellow, Chris Line, wrote a letter to the city and got all three of them removed. In June of this year, our intake attorney, Maddie Ziegler, was able to remove this "In God We Trust" plaque from a post office in Shelbyville, Indiana. "In God We Trust" complaints are hard to get victories on because it's the national motto, and most government officials don't believe that it's religious. But but the post office has very specific and very stringent regulations on what can be posted on its buildings. So Maddie wrote the postmaster and noted that the regulations say, quote, "Except for official postal and other government notices, no signs may be deposited on exteriors of the postal buildings." And the postmaster had this removed. Another interesting complaint that she handled involved church parking only signs in Keyport, New Jersey. They are unconstitutional, but the case law in this area is very little. So we still wrote to the city and told them that through these signs they were endorsing religion, privileging church-going residents over non-church-going residents, and basically subsidizing free parking for Christians. The city agreed and removed the signs. Now, this church parking issue comes back to San Francisco because there was a huge issue here that's been going on for the last 6 years and was just resolved this summer. I got a complaint 6 years ago from a resident here in San Francisco who said, "I can't park on my own street on Sundays because the church is handing out its own parking passes for people, evading parking regulations and just letting people park wherever they want, including the median of the street." We wrote a letter to the city and they were really reluctant to comply with us. But they did convene a working group of local residents and church leaders to try to resolve this problem. And the way that they did that was this year, they decided that anybody can park in the median on Sunday. Another area of complaint is government funding for religion. Our staff attorney, Ryan Jane, works on the majority of these types of complaints. And last November, he worked on a complaint out of North Carolina that involved a $72,500 grant to a church that would allow them to paint a new mural on the inside walls of their church. So here's a clip explaining what happened there.
A Wisconsin-based nonprofit is trying to stop a mural from going up at an Asheville church. It stems from Explore Asheville CVB awarding a $72,000 grant to Haywood Street Congregation. The church commissioned an artist to paint a fresco on the central wall of the church's sanctuary featuring Jesus' famous Sermon on the Mount. But the Freedom from Religion Foundation says someone from the area complained that Explore Asheville CVB should not be awarding the church a grant to make it happen.
So this is just a huge windfall for the church, not just for visitors, but that they are able to spread their religious message, and the county cannot be paying for that.
We reached out to the CVB. The executive director said, quote, "We have received the inquiry and it is being reviewed by our legal counsel."
So there was a lot of media attention with that complaint and a lot of negative outcry, and the church voluntarily rescinded their request for the grant. So our complaint did save the taxpayer $72,000. A new and burgeoning area of state church complaints, of course, involves government entities and religious postings on social media sites. The case law, again, is pretty scant in this area, but it's clear that religious postings by government officials on official social media sites are unconstitutional. And these violations come in so many different forms, from Facebook postings to tweets to viral videos. Since the last convention, we've sent 44 letters combating religious promotion on social media. 13 of those letters were educational letters to politicians, and we didn't request any sort of response. But 11 of those, or 35%, or 13 of those letters, no, excuse me, 11 of the remaining letters, or 35%, turned into victories, and 10 of those were to law enforcement offices. And last year, you may have, or this past summer, you may recall that it was all the rage for police departments and other EMTs, first responder departments, to do this lip sync challenge, and they post their videos online. I actually really liked the one from the San Francisco Police Department because they did Journey. But some of them decided to use the opportunity to proselytize. For instance, the Crandall Police Department in Texas filmed a video of themselves singing a Christian worship song. And I'm not going to make you listen to the whole thing, but you do have to listen to a little bit. And I really hope it doesn't get stuck in your head like it's in mine. And this world. It's also not very good lip syncing. But shockingly, the police department doubled down and asserted that they were fine to post this. We decided to not pursue it any further because thankfully, this is a passing fad and unlikely to recur. So I am going to end back here in California, where we complained about a mayor's prayer breakfast here in Bueno Park, California. Prayer breakfasts are typically difficult to complain about as well, because most of the times they are hosted by private organizations where elected officials are invited to attend. But sometimes we do get complaints like this one where the city is really involved. The city here was selling tickets from City Hall, and if you wanted to call to find out more information about the breakfast, you called City Hall to figure that out. We also did an open records request and found out that their city staff was really involved in the coordination of this event. event. So Elizabeth Cavell wrote to them, said that this was inappropriate and unconstitutional, and the city agreed. And they've actually also changed the name from the Mayor's Prayer Breakfast to the Community Prayer Breakfast and handed it completely over to a 501c3 organization that will organize it in the future. So now I'm going to let Patrick tell you about litigation.
Thank you, Rebecca. Larry Decker accused us of being an attack dog, so I'll talk about some of our attack dog activities. We do have a lot of ongoing cases, so this is going to be just a survey. And I've tried to just categorize into, I guess, four different categories, really, of the cases that we've got generally that are ongoing. Some of the religious displays that you've been hearing about, financial aid to religion, discrimination cases, which are some of the most important, as well as promotion of prayer, as well as religious worship. And so in the first context, what we're not seeing a lot today, and probably because of groups like FFRF, are new religious displays going up like this, as blatant as what happened in the state capitol in Arkansas this year of this new Ten Commandments monument with the state senator, Jason Rapert, standing next to it. So this is a new case for us. We're working jointly with other civil rights groups to oppose this type of display. And really what goes on with a lot of these display cases is territory marking, signaling this state or this community are a Christian community. And so, you know, sometimes they would say, they obviously cite and say this is somehow historic, even though it's a brand new monument. But I think there are deeper issues involved in making sure that places aren't marked or given credit as being particularly Christian places. And one of the cases that I've been working on for a few years, this is the official seal of Lehigh County, Pennsylvania. You can see there's a Latin cross in both the center of the seal and the flag that they have. We brought suit against that and won in the district court. And this is a theme that you're going to be seeing. We're winning, and these other groups are now trying to take it to some of the highest levels of courts and appealing. But with this case, what's interesting, in order to defend sometimes religious symbols, the governments are pushed to trying to secularize them, trying to secularize the cross. And so in this case, the county lawyers had been arguing that the cross really just symbolized the settlers of the county who were Christian. So it's certainly, I think, from a state church perspective, not in the interest of Christians to argue that the Latin cross, a deeply religious symbol with meaning, doesn't have that symbol. We obviously recognize its meaning. And another cross case that Rebecca Markert and Maddie Ziegler in our office are working jointly with the American Humanist Association. This is from Pensacola, Florida, in a city park there. And I think we have a clip that will show kind of bringing you up to speed on the latest with this case.
Florida, a cross has stood at a local public park in one way or another since 1941. But now, a federal appeals court has ruled that this 34-foot cross at Bayview Park is unconstitutional and must be taken down. The cross has been at the center of a legal battle for the past 2 years. The group behind the lawsuit sued the city of Pensacola, calling the cross unconstitutional because they say it's on public land and it violates the separation of church and state. They say it's not about being offended, but about the constitutional principle of equal treatment of religion by government. In this storied community, others are taking the stance that this monument should withstand the First Amendment challenges that it's facing right now because it's a passive monument of historical significance. The city has 14 days to ask for a rehearing. Now, if the Bayview cross comes down, a separate 10-foot-tall cross at a nearby beach there in Pensacola could also be in legal jeopardy.
And so that case we won both at the district court and at the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals. It is on which is another theme, is that the religious organizations, in this case the Beckett Fund, are trying to seek higher review. And so this is an ongoing case, but for the moment we have prevailed both in the district court and in the Court of Appeals. I guess this is one of the bad things about working at FFRF is I now associate places with the state church violations that are there. And so the lawyers have this too when we travel, and that's how we think of places. So This is not a new case that I'll talk about, but one that's local to here at least. We have an image here of this is from Santa Clara, California. Rebecca had been working for years to get this 14-foot cross removed from a city park in nearby Santa Clara. And they seemed to be that they would actually remove it until they basically did force us to file a lawsuit, and we did that jointly with David Kalianidis. So on the right, you can see it's not a perfect matchup, but in 2017, the city did, in fact, remove the cross. So I associate Santa Clara now with this violation. And the final display case I'll mention is actually one of our displays. So I don't know if you've seen FFRF's Bill of Rights nativity display. We've put these up in other places. But usually it's only when there's been a forum created to try to get something religious to be put on property. So we sought to put this up and were given a permit in the Texas state capitol. I'm sorry, Texas, there's gonna be more Texas commentary. But Governor Abbott, after it had been approved and had been up for several days, ordered it to be removed. And he basically described this display as indecent and mocking, and I think he said it indicated that it would contributed to immorality. And it's really just, the founding fathers looking upon the Bill of Rights, and it was a celebration of the Bill of Rights. So this is one case that we've pursued. We won in the district court this June, a final order against Governor Abbott that we have a free speech right to place this display. Texas, however, is appealing. And I don't know if any of the Texas members here maybe know that Abbott has often criticized FFRF over the years, even when he was attorney general. But with our new win, I've suggested a slight change to the a popular motto for the state. We'd say, do mess with Texas. And I'll move on to our financial aid to religion cases. And so here we have Dan and Annie Laurie pictured with. These are the briefs of mostly churches in one of our cases. This is how afraid they are that we may win in our challenge to the housing allowance provided to ministers of the gospel. They can get paid by their church and not pay income tax on that income, which really nobody else can do. If you get paid, you're going to have to pay your fair share of taxes. So thanks to Dan and Annie Laurie, we prevailed. We won in the district court, and this was ruled that this was unconstitutional. Which is a huge victory. This is nearly $1 billion a year that is not being taxed. And so right in line with our theme, these wins are being appealed. This was just argued in the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals just this past few weeks. So we are waiting a decision ultimately on this case, but it's certainly an important one. And in line with these tax cases, FFRF's board created in recent years a charity, Non-Belief Relief, which helps human suffering across the world. But one thing that you may not know about nonprofits is that their tax returns are public. You can look up the 990 tax return for nonprofits. Churches don't have to do that, so there's very little public accountability for churches. And so Non-Belief Relief did not file a public 990 tax returns. And the IRS revoked its tax exemption this August. And so we're pursuing a discrimination complaint in the fact that Non-Belief Relief has lost its tax exemption, and any church doesn't have to go through this onerous process to retain and get its tax exemption. So that's a new case that FFRF brought. And we have a depiction here of, this was when President Trump in 2017 signed an executive order, which he claimed was going to allow churches to advocate for or against candidates for office. And so this is him doing the signing. FFRF shortly after sued. And really this is a win in a way, because when the Department of Justice had to defend his executive order, they basically said that no, federal law still prohibits churches from electioneering, advocating for or against candidates for office. And so this is really a win. He obviously wants the law to be differently than it is. Thanks to the Secular Coalition for America and our And our advocates like Andrew have so far prevented Congress from changing this law, but it's certainly something to keep an eye on is whether this law, federal law that prohibits electioneering will be changed in the future. You've heard from David Stecchetti about our Morris County win. I just wanted to note another local connection. This church and the county have sought Supreme Court, U.S. Supreme Court review. We are represented in that case by an extraordinary constitutional law scholar and author, Professor Erwin Chemerinsky, who is the dean of the Berkeley Law School here in nearby. So we are in good hands with his expert counsel on that case. And in our discrimination case realm, Rebecca mentioned we filed some important amicus briefs. One of those in the Masterpiece Cake Shop case, where you know a Colorado baker claimed he could discriminate against a gay couple. Elizabeth Cavell wrote a brief basically writing that people's religious beliefs shouldn't trump our secular laws. We also filed a brief, and Rebecca authored that in the Muslim travel ban case, and we argued that was an obvious attempt at violating the Establishment Clause. And so this is a product that we're putting out that's not our own cases, but we are doing advocacy that's reaching some of the highest levels of court. And you may have heard of Dan's case against the chaplain and the U.S. House of Representatives. This is a case where Dan was prohibited, even though he had a sponsor from the U.S. House, Representative Pocan, to deliver an opening invocation or prayer. The chaplain had denied him that. And the district court, not really wanting to rule on the merits, said that we didn't have standing. However, I'm pleased to announce that Andrew did a valiant job arguing this case again just in October, and we're expecting that the case should be reinstated ultimately, or hopefully, when the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals issues a ruling in that case. You may have seen David Williamson, the gentleman in the middle at the convention. He's here, I know. He, like Dan and these two other gentlemen with him, were excluded from delivering invocations at the Brevard County, Florida commissioners meeting. And they also prevailed in their case in the district court. That's a coalition effort with other organizations like the ACLU and Americans United. That case is also currently on appeal, and we expect arguments in early 2019. You've heard from David Kalianidis about our Ninth Circuit win, and I just wanted to point out for everybody that's here, if you live in the Ninth Circuit, it's why this is such an important win. It's the largest federal circuit by far, with almost 62 million people in the circuit. So that victory in the Ninth Circuit has a huge impact for the entire region, and so we're very grateful for David's work, and hopefully this win will have a large impact on the entire region, given the size of the circuit. And finally, on our prayer, fourth category of kind of prayer issues, this is a new case that I've worked on with our cooperating counsel in Parkersburg, West Virginia. They do the Lord's Prayer at every single meeting that they've been doing for at least 10 years. And it's not even that they do the Lord's Prayer, but there's particular members on the city council who've been outright hostile to people who are not participating in the prayer. So I have a brief video clip. You'll have to hear a little bit of a prayer, but hopefully you can see what I'm talking about.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory of our Amen. Amen.
And so... earlier in the clip, that's the city councilman Eric Barber was staring at the people not participating and motioned to his microphone to yell amen at them, just as Jesus would have wanted. But this is a new case that we're seeking an injunction, which the court could rule on any day now. But what's interesting about this particular council member, you probably think you don't know anything about a West Virginia city council member. Some of you probably have heard of him, but not for a good reason. After Brett Kavanaugh was confirmed to the Supreme Court, he went to social media and issued this comment, which immediately went national, where he said, better get your coat hangers ready, liberals. And so this is the other side of our case of who we're dealing with. Thankfully, people in the community have really started to push back at the just overt religiosity of of their city council. So that's my brief survey of our cases that we have ongoing, and we have Andrew will bring you up to speed on our strategic response.
Okay, so we're getting back some time here. He spelled your wrong too, and we couldn't leave it up there without correcting it. The strategic response team just turned 1 year old. FFRF formed the SRT after the last convention. We are part of the legal department. We are kind of a mix between legal, communications, editorial. We do a little bit of everything. This is your strategic response team. Annie Laurie did not make it to the photo for some reason. You were here, Annie Laurie, actually, already. But you have the director of communications, Amit, Rebecca. That's Ryan Jane with the beard, and then Christina and Bailey, who are our legal and editorial assistants. And we do a couple different things. So we do lobbying, and we do all the tracking of legislation for FFRF and analyzing that legislation. We try to shape public opinion with editorials, articles, and letters to the editor. We work on drafting statements and press releases and action alerts for FFRF. And then we work to stop imminent violations before they occur, such as taking school children to the Kentucky Ark Park that revels in genocide. And I'm going to talk about each one of these, but we also get tasked with these weird miscellaneous things that come into FFRF, like this. This was Mike Huckabee sent a fundraising letter about FFRF, 10 pages of just this anti-FFRF screed on behalf of Citizens United. That Citizens United, the one you're thinking of right now. I spent too many hours rebutting all the lies in this letter, but my favorite, hands down, I wanted to share with you. So if you can't read that from where you are, their lawyers, there being FFRF lawyers, are slick and well-funded, and quite frankly, that's why I'm so afraid. So Mike Huckabee is afraid of us. It's kind of flattering, really. And we are many things. We are committed, we are hardworking, but we are not slick and we are not well-funded, but you could help that if you would care to donate to the... So we also take care of the lobbying and legislative tracking for FFRF. This is one of our primary duties. We do a lot of work with Larry Decker and the SCA. How many of you remember this guy, this face? This is Jeff Mateer. That name ring a bell for anybody? It's probably good that you don't remember his name, but this is one of our biggest victories this year. He was up for a lifetime appointment on the federal bench. He used to work at an outfit called First Liberty Institute, which is not a bank. It's the anti-FFRF. They work to tear down that wall of separation that we seek to protect. And so to stop him, we really dug into his background and authored the most comprehensive report on his unfitness for the federal bench out there. Media actually used this to write stories connecting him to First Liberty and pointing out the problems with him going on the federal bench. Other advocacy groups also used it. And we worked with some of those groups and the journalists. And we also worked to publish this video that I thought you might enjoy.
As bad as you think it is, it's worse. We're going to talk about the elephant in the room, and the elephant in the room is homosexuality. They speak of it as same-sex marriage, but it's so much more than that. It's really a right to engage in homosexual conduct, and their objective is to purge religion from public life.
I don't see anything about right to same-sex marriage. I don't see anything saying right to homosexuality. I don't see anything about right to privacy in the 14th Amendment.
Sexual liberty is code for homosexuality, transgenderism, bisexuality. We were looking at something on Facebook now. There's a male, female, other. Why couldn't four people want to get married? Why not one man and three women, or three women and one man? And I mean, it's disgusting. But that's not going on in our community. Oh, yes, it is. We're back to that time where debauchery rules. I mean, that's the right they're seeking. Anything goes being elevated into our Constitution. First grader really knows what their sexual identity. I mean, it just shows you how Satan's plan is working.
Our motto is to protect people not only to believe, but also to be able to act on those beliefs.
So that video was watched and shared tens of thousands of times online, and it led to a lot of people calling in. Most importantly, Rebecca and I met with members of the Senate Judiciary Committee to educate them about this guy. And we're proud to say that in December, Trump rescinded his nomination. So he is not going to be on the federal bench. So that's an example of our successful lobbying. Another part of the lobbying that we do is herding cats. I mean mobilizing godless and secular Americans. Got that wrong there, sorry. Since the last convention, you have made 30,000 connections with federal legislators. This is emails and calls that we have asked you to make that you have turned around and done. This only includes the federal level. It doesn't include state and local calls or emails. But this is a huge number. And this doesn't include contact via social media either, or contact that was generated via shares on social media. So the number is probably significantly higher than this. I would actually like to see it a lot higher than that, even. We issued 109 action alerts. I don't know what it's going to be in the coming year. It's probably not going to be quite that high, especially not with the Supreme, well, fingers crossed, not with the Supreme Court nomination. But I would actually like you all to sign up for our system right now. So we're going to do audience participation. If you guys want to get out your phones, this is very easy to do. It'll take you less than a minute. If you text FFRF to 52886, on your phone, you're going to get a link back, and all you have to do is put in your address. We need your address because that's how the system knows where you are and who your legislator is, and because our districts are gerrymandered to hell, we actually need your full address. But then whenever there is something going on in your area that you can take action on, that you can call your legislator, or that you can call or email your legislator, you will get an alert right there on your phone. And the system makes it so easy for you to take action on the things that you care about. So it's really important to do. You'll get that link back. Please go ahead and fill it out when you do. In terms of tracking legislation, we tracked 115 bills this past year, and 80% of them were bad. I'm going to put that back up at the end for everybody if you missed it. Don't worry. We also were successful in stopping a lot of these bills. There was a bill in Florida that would have forced all public schools to allow the Boy Scouts to come into the classroom during class time and recruit. And as you know, the Boy Scouts discriminate against non-religious students. We opposed that. That bill went down. There was another bill requiring all schools in West Virginia, including elementary schools, to have Bible classes. That bill went down. In Mississippi, there was a bill to have the teachers in public schools read the Ten Commandments every day. That bill went down. And then we just found out actually last week that these proposed science standard changes in Arizona, which would have watered down the teaching of evolution, that those failed. So have been doing a lot of work on that. Most notably, though, is one that was already talked about, Project Blitz. So this is a Christian nationalist legislative agenda. It is a push to codify Christian nationalism at all levels of government. One of the big things they've been doing is, as Larry mentioned, trying to put In God We Trust into our public schools. These are the states that have already passed laws, either allowing or requiring In God We Trust to be displayed in our public schools. And one of the big fights we had on this was in Florida, with a Florida state representative named Kimberly Daniels. And as far as I'm concerned, this fight is not over. We were beating Kimberly Daniels on this In God We Trust in Every Public School issue for a while. We were fighting her, we were winning, and I want to show you that we did another advocacy video, and I just want to show you this because it's got some great clips from her that gives you a good flavor of who she is here.
Florida State Representative Kimberly Daniels is on a mission, a religious mission, to get organized religion back into the public schools.
To adopt rules that require all schools and all buildings used by the school to display in a conspicuous place the state motto, In God We Trust.
In God She Trusts, so she wants every public school to display In God We Trust.
The spiritual air force and the demons in the air and on the earth. And
a self-proclaimed preacher and exorcist, she's never been shy about this theocratic goal, openly proclaiming it as she fights demons, battles witches, and breaks curses.
But God had to anoint me to go in the gates of the city, to go in the chambers of the city, to write laws and to be able to debate and write legislation
so that his kingdom could come and manifest itself like never before.
We have to be kingdom-minded no matter what realm we operate in. Even in every position that I hold, whether I'm working in the professional arena, whether I'm working in the legislative arena, you have to be kingdom-minded.
Theocracy of God, the kingdom agenda, as opposed to the government agenda.
I'm a commissioner in Jacksonville, Florida, and don't nobody tell me I can't pray nowhere. I can pray anywhere I go. Now you gonna let me swear in on the Bible and tell me I can't preach it? The devil is a liar.
So that's the exorcist and Florida state representative who we were beating until the Parkland shooting, which she used to push that bill that was nearly defeated through. So instead of dealing with guns and school safety, they put both in God's non-existent hands. We are not done with this one yet. Now, shaping public opinion is another thing that the strategic response team is supposed to do. We work a lot on this. It's very hard to track, but the goal is to get FFRF's message out there to both members and to the public at large. We do this with statements, op-eds, letters to the editor. We did 44 statements since the last convention on a wide variety of issues, from FEMA funding the repair of churches, to Brett Kavanaugh, to the Religious Freedom Division at HHS, to the Pennsylvania grand jury report that came out. We also did another 50 articles, op-eds, and blogs, and letters to the editor. These are a couple that I wrote for Think Progress, Religion News Service. Amit and Annie Laurie just recently had a couple published in the Chicago Tribune. And together, we've also written 33 different articles for FFRF's blog, Free Thought Now. We really like this as an outlet because it's got a young readership, especially for nonprofits. 60% are under the age of 34, the readers on that. And there's a couple joint articles, one I wrote with Elizabeth Cavell, and another one I wrote with Sam Grover that generated a lot of discussion. So we've talked about the first three things that the strategic response team does. I want to take just a little bit to talk about the last one, rapid response. This is working to stop imminent violations of the Constitution. The legal team will hear about something, a violation that's going to happen later today or tomorrow, and rather than derailing the whole legal team on it, Ryan and I will take it on. This prevents, it's a better use of resources for us. And it's not just imminent violations, but it's also violations where we can, if we act quickly, we can change the discussion about this. And a good example of that, we actually have two from February 22nd. Of this year. We wrote two really fast letters. The first was about Billy Graham lying in state in the US Capitol. And because of that fast response, our side of this argument was actually featured on CNN. It would have been, without us getting that letter out, it would have been this fawning paean to Billy Graham and why he should be lying in state in the Capitol. Instead, they actually covered the godless side of this as well, pointing out that, hey, this is a state church problem too. Also on that day, the state superintendent for South Carolina issued a video in which she declared that the way to solve school shootings was to, by quote, sharing Christ's love. So we wanted to do something about that as quickly as we could. We wanted the video to come down, and we also wanted to take that opportunity to educate South Carolina because that's a state that apparently needs it. So we got a letter out to that superintendent in 27 minutes in Dan and Annie Laurie's name. And we're also successful on the rapid response issues. This is an example where we heard about a grant that was going out to a church in Sitka, Alaska for $5,000 for repair. And once that money goes out the door, it's really hard to get it back. We sent the letter again same day and to the attorney at Sitka, and that money stayed with the taxpayers instead of going to the church. So this is just a sample of what the strategic response team does. We handled more than 450 projects this past year. Many you will never hear about. We can't tell you about them. Lobbying is by its nature behind the scenes work, but you should know that your interests are being really well represented, more so than ever before. And we did want to leave time for questions today, and I think you want to do 10 minutes? Yeah, so we're going to do 10 minutes of questions. There is a microphone, and I think there's, is there just the one buzz in the middle? There's, okay, there's two, so you guys can line up. I also, while you're lining up, and we have two wireless mics, I want to add a coda to what Stephen Hurdle was saying earlier. Stephen, when you introduced Larry, you mentioned the Pittsburgh mayor's comments included atheists. And I just wanted to point out that on October 13th, 2017, FFRF wrote a letter to the mayor of Pittsburgh about a prayer rally that he was sponsoring. And in it, we wrote, "As mayor of Pittsburgh, you represent a diverse population that consists not only of the religious, but also of atheists and agnostics who do not believe in prayer, Jesus, or a deity. We asked him to stop, quote, alienating non-believers throughout your city by turning them into political outsiders in their own communities at a time when grieving and unity are so important." So this was just an educational letter. We didn't ask for a response, but it turns out that he incorporated the ideas that we were trying to educate him on into his next statement. So, and I just wanted to add that because Rebecca mentioned we often don't hear about the victories that we get. That's a perfect example of it. So go ahead. Woody, is that you?
It is.
Blinded by the light.
I was delighted to hear about what Rebecca and you did in stopping and causing the president to withdraw a nomination to the federal judiciary. And you mentioned that you met with the members of the Senate Judiciary Committee. And I was wondering if it might be more convenient for you if you actually had an office in Washington so that you could do that regularly.
Woody's been trying to get some of us to Washington for quite a while. So you have to talk to Dan and Annie Laurie about that.
Yes, so good news clubs. They are everywhere. They are insidious. And they are tearing our school children apart. What is being done, or what can we do to take action against this very insidious form of evangelicism?
Well, so good news clubs are technically allowed if they are done the right way. If you see one in your community, you should look into whether or not they are obeying the appropriate legal boundaries. Most of the time, they're not. We have a great FAQ up on the FFRF website about what is allowed and what is not allowed and what would cross the line. And we've actually been able to stop some. But the other thing you can do that's been very successful is shining a light on the program itself.
Right.
You know, this is a program that tells kids if they don't believe a certain way, they're going to hell. They don't sell it as that kind of program. They sell it as, hey, this is fun. Your kids are going to get candy and pizza, and we'll watch them for an hour.
Would stapling the application to a child's homework be perhaps sort of an endorsement?
Yeah, that could be a problem. Yeah. Again, yeah. Look at the FAQ is definitely the suggestion. And if you got a violation, please see us afterwards. We're happy to talk about it, and be sure to submit it to the website. But yeah, good news clubs are—they're a cancer on the public schools.
Thank you for your work.
Yeah.
Just so you know, if you had an update on the North Carolina legislature that was earmarking money for the religious organizations.
We're not going to talk about that right now.
Okay.
For good reason. We can talk about it later, though. We don't want to be public about that at this particular moment.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course. For good reason. Trust us. You'll know. I think we're going in the back now. I can't see everybody in the back.
We hear a lot of problems stemming from the religious right. I'm very, very curious to know if FFRF has any allies for lack of a better term, the religious left, who believe in the separation of church and state. Do you have any support from liberalistic religious groups who act as allies or something of the sort?
Yeah, I mean, we obviously work with other organizations. I mean, for one, Americans United, which doesn't have any religious association, but the Baptist Joint Committee for Religious Liberty is a very good state church separation organization that supports a lot of the work that we do and supports the rights of non-believers to have their non-belief. So there are obviously people out there. It's becoming more rare that the churches themselves would have a strong state church separation perspectives, and maybe that's because society's religiosity is waning and that churches are holding on to it. But there are other groups that are religious that do support state church separation that we work with.
And We work with them a lot on our amicus briefs. A lot of amicus briefs are submitted with a coalition of groups. And so we've had Anti-Defamation League sign on to some of our briefs and Interfaith Alliance and things like that. So that is definitely a coalition that's happening as well.
Okay, front microphone.
Thank you.
Hi, Andrew. I'm Valerie Peters from the Portland contingent. I've been a member of the FFRF organization in Portland with Cheryl since it started a few years ago. And my most depressing recent event was the nomination of Judge Kavanaugh for many personal reasons, and as a woman growing up and seeing the rights that women have attained in the last 30 years, I feel like that was a very backward step, and I'm just curious whether FFRF was able to address that issue, or if there are things going forward that we can do to address that issue.
Sure.
Well, yes, we were. The changing federal courts has been one of our priorities in this the last 2 years, really, because not just at the Supreme Court level, but Trump is nominating a record number of judges to the federal bench.
Exactly.
And we have been, as you know, Andrew mentioned, we've been fighting against these nominations through lobbying with Congress and educating the public on what these nominees are actually saying and what they're about. We did do a lot on Judge Kavanaugh. Do you want to talk about that a little bit,
yeah,
Andrew?
Yeah, I was going to talk about it, but I cut it because it's depressing and we were short on time. We were on the document review team that was trying to get through all the documents that were not being released. FFRF attorneys reviewed more than 15,000 documents for this team. We did do a full vetting of all Trump's nominees, including Kavanaugh, on the shortlist. So we sent another report on him to the Senate Judiciary. We met with Senate Judiciary Committee staff members, educated them on the state church angle and the problems that we saw there. We did a number of action alerts. Those almost 30,000 contacts, half of those were people speaking out against Kavanaugh. I mean, we pulled out all the stops to try and prevent him from getting in. And I mean, obviously, we were not successful. The math just did not work, unfortunately. There may be ways in the future, depending on what the documents that have not been reviewed show. But you know, I don't know the answer to that. But it was a blow to not just people in general, but also to the Supreme Court as an institution, I think.
And I think all civil rights organizations now are looking at their strategies and what we can do now that the federal courts may be a bar to our issues and how we can re-strategize and still fight this fight without necessarily going to court. So be it in the legislative realm or the court of public opinion and just, you know, shaming people for these things. It's something that not just FFRF is going through, but a lot of different organizations around the country.
In the back, please.
In Arizona, we have a unique fight going on, and that's that we have two Koch-funded freedom centers at both of our state universities. And from those freedom centers, they are writing textbooks that are trying to get into our high schools that are funded by the Templeton Foundation. So we've got a problem with the word freedom because we've got all the free market capitalists putting money in our state for school vouchers. And we've got the Templeton Foundation and their religiosity pushing these textbooks free into, you know, cash-strapped high schools. And I'm wondering if you've had any success in fighting with the Templeton Foundation or the Koch-funded Freedom Centers, because they're bastardizing the word freedom and pushing these ideals down into the high schools that are very dangerous. My favorite sentence from the textbooks is that Neanderthals became extinct because they weren't entrepreneurs, and Jamestown failed because it didn't have private property rights.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
There's a mix between religion and capitalists like the Kochs,
yeah, the
that probably
their,
needs to really be watched.
Entrepreneurial spirit.
I mean, so far we haven't received a lot of information or complaints on that particular issue. But across the U.S., we are getting complaints and working with school districts about curriculum for schools. because some of the worst publishers are fundamentalist publishers like Bob Jones University Press, Abeka Books, and public schools, including public charter schools, are using those materials. And so that is something that is on our radar and that we've been pushing back. But I'm just not generally familiar with this particular issue. It's certainly something that people in Arizona should complain about to the appropriate officials, both at the state level and at your local district level.
And I just want to say one more thing about just sort of the bastardization of language. You know, we've written and talked a lot the past 2 years at the Freedom From Religion Foundation about the attempt to redefine religious liberty or religious freedom, and to weaponize religious liberty and religious freedom, and into a right to impose your beliefs on other people, and that's one of the biggest problems that we are facing right now. That's the fight that the other side wants to have and take to the Brett Kavanaugh Supreme Court and get that license to discriminate. So we're very aware of the problems with language, and we've been working to undo the damage that they are trying to do on that front as well.
Thank you.
Let's take it back.
So I have a question about cake. If I owned a cake shop and joined the Church of Jesus Christ Caucasian, sincerely held beliefs, could I sincerely prevent anybody who is not Caucasian from buying a cake in my cake shop?
If you're asking if the court grants the license to discriminate on the basis of religious belief, will they be able to stop the discrimination against racial minorities? I think the answer is no. I think if you listen to the oral argument in the Masterpiece Cake Shop case, it was very clear that one of the things the justices were worried about is, if we allow you to discriminate against LGBTQ citizens, we can't figure out how to draw a line that prevents you from discriminating on the basis of race. I think it's a very, legally, there's no real way to do it. If you allow one, you have to allow
all
of them.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I think we'll do one last question, folks, sorry. We will be around, you can come find us. We're happy to keep talking, but we gotta let everybody else go to lunch. So, last question in the back, please.
My question is on, what are we doing to fight against the National Day of Prayer? Federal, state, and local levels. To me, it's one of the most insidious and dangerous ways to theocratize the nation, and most of the politicians jump on that bandwagon. I just wonder what we can do to prevent that.
Right. Well, we have a First Amendment that says, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, and we have Congress designating a holiday for prayer. We tried to challenge that in federal court and prevailed.
We successfully challenged it.
Prevailed in the district court. However, the court's not wanting to rule on it, basically say, hey, you don't have standing. We don't know who would have standing to challenge that type of thing. So at the federal level, we're very limited in our ability to challenge it legally. Obviously, people can comment to their elected leaders why this is such a bad holiday and a bad law. Locally, I think there are opportunities, particularly under state constitutions for challenge, or if your mayor's office or your local legislator are participating in these, let them know about it. Be in their ear about it, because I don't think they're getting enough feedback from people who disagree with it. It's politically advantageous for them to continue to cloak themselves in religion and to cloak themselves in the National Day of Prayer. So really, it's both a legislative solution and potentially a legal solution if it's in a place where we may be able to have a legal challenge.
All right, if you didn't get to ask your question, please come find us. We are happy to keep talking. Otherwise, go get yourself some lunch, and thank you.
Thank you very much.